I broke my ankle December 7th while I was out for a run. And I learned very quickly in these past few weeks how difficult it is to do a lot of things when you're in a cast. So in this video, I'm going to share with you how I broke my ankle and some tips that I've learned along the way on how to make life a little bit easier getting around in a cast. My name is Jelena, and as I mentioned, I broke my ankle while I was out for a run. I was out running and I came to a quick stop at a corner and my ankle, it buckled, it rolled, and I fell to the ground. When I tried to move my leg to stand up, it hurt and I couldn't put any weight on my left foot. So I knew something was wrong, so I called my husband John to come and get me. When I got home, I could tell that my foot was swelling. So I wanted to get my shoe off before my foot swelled so bad the shoe had to be cut off. So I was freaking out while I was taking this shoe off because I didn't know what I had hurt and how bad it was hurt. And I didn't want to injure myself more by getting this shoe off. So it was a very slow and frantic process. Once I got it off, I couldn't move my foot around at all without it hurting really badly. So I called a nearby urgent care because I wasn't sure if I should go to an urgent care or to the ER. So the urgent care, they said that their x-ray machine was fixed and then I should just go to them and they could help me out. So John helped me into the car and drove me over to the urgent care. When we got there, he checked me in and he came back out with a nurse and a wheelchair so that I could get inside without him having to carry me. I'm going to show you a few pictures now of what my ankle looked like at the urgent care. So if you don't want to see it, close your eyes or look away until the music stops. It's not super gory. There's not bones sticking out or anything. It's just really swollen. So close your eyes, look away. Here are the pictures coming up now. It's safe to look again. My ankle, it was x-rayed. They said it was definitely broken. I broke the fibula bone down at the ankle and they put a splint on it, a temporary splint. I was also referred to an orthopedic doctor so that they could take a better look at it and put me most likely in a cast. They said it would take that doctor's office a few days to call me, so if I hadn't heard in a few days, to give that office a call. The urgent care was out of crutches, so they sent me down the street to the Walgreens to see if they had any. Walgreens was out, Target was out, King Supers was out, so I remembered that I had a friend whose husband was on crutches a little while ago. So I texted her to see if they still had them, and thankfully they did. They weren't going to be home for a little while, so in the meantime, while we got home and were waiting for them, my husband, he went upstairs and he brought an office chair that has wheels on it downstairs so that I could scoot myself around and while I was waiting for the crutches to arrive. I didn't realize her husband was so much taller than me, and the crutches, the shortest they would go is for someone that was 5'10", a bit taller than my 5'6" frame. I could use them to get upstairs, but I was pretty unstable. So I went upstairs and I took a bath, and while I was taking a bath, John went to head to some thrift stores to see if he could find some crutches. Well, while he was at one of the stores, he ran into another friend who said, "Oh, hey, I happen to have crutches at home that should be just the right height." So he swung by their house, picked those up, and we were all set on crutches. I'm sorry that I had to do this part vertical, but it was the best way for me to get all of me in the shot. So the crutches, how to use them. These armrests are more the armpit rests. You're not really supposed to put any weight on them, I guess, unless you're balancing kind of like this. I'm also balancing a lot on my right foot here. You are supposed to put all of your weight on these handles when you're moving forward. So these parts are just kind of loose and kind of up against your body, not resting there like that, to keep your balance, and then you hop forward. So. As far as where these should land, when they're upright, they should be about 2 to 3 finger widths below your armpits. The handles are supposed to fall at your wrist height. And then you grab onto them, put all your weight on them. So that makes carrying anything pretty difficult. So one handy thing that I have that I did not realize would come so handy is this little pouch thing that my mother-in-law gave me over the summer. I can fit my phone in here and a chapstick easily, and it's magnetic in the back. So I just have to pull it open,
I can just kind of put it in place on the handle and it snaps shut. And I can easily transition this from the crutch to the knee scooter, which I'll talk about in a little bit. So this is the fun of getting around on crutches.
Well, I was not going to wait a few days for that orthopedic doctor's office to call me, so the next morning I was on the phone trying to get an appointment with them. I actually managed to get in for the following day, so it was really quick, and when I got there, they took more x-rays and confirmed that the fibula bone was broken. They were going to put me in a cast for a week. I would come back in, they would saw the cast off, take more x-rays and make sure the bone was healing correctly, and then put another cast on that I would wear for another 3 to 5 weeks, making a total of 4 to 6 weeks that I would be in a cast. While I was in the cast, I needed to keep all weight off of it. I could rest my foot on something, but no standing or putting any kind of weight on it other than just resting it. So to prevent me from getting a blood clot, they recommended that I take 1 aspirin every day. They also told me to keep my foot elevated above my heart as much as possible. They also gave me a referral for a knee scooter, if I wanted one, because getting around on crutches is tough. I definitely was going to take advantage of it, because I had gotten messages from multiple friends on Instagram already telling me that I definitely needed to get a knee scooter. They have an office within the orthopedic office that does the orthotics and assistive devices for all the injured people that come into the doctor's office, so I didn't have to go far to get it. Before I left the orthopedic office, I asked the doctor if there was anything that I could do to help my bone heal faster. The only thing he mentioned was to increase my vitamin D intake. He asked me if I knew what my current levels were, and I was thinking that it was somewhere in the 30s, so he said to double whatever I was currently taking to get that up even higher and closer to 100. I was already taking 5,000 IUs daily, so I upped it to 10,000 IUs. Then I looked up what my levels actually were, and it turns out in June, when I last had my blood drawn, my levels were somewhere in the 70s. So I decreased what I was taking from the 10,000 IUs to 7,000 IUs daily. Once I got home, I looked up what else I could do to help speed up the healing process of my bone. The common things that I saw that were recommended were: increase your vitamin D intake, increase your calcium intake, increase the number of calories you're eating, and increase the amount of protein you're eating. Since I'm already taking calcium daily, I decided that on the days that I could remember, I would take a second calcium pill, since you can only absorb 500 milligrams at a time, and that's the size of the pills that I have that I take. Since your body is working extra hard to heal the break in your bone, it makes sense that you need a few extra calories to help fuel that recovery. Luckily, I broke it in December when there is no shortage of extra calories around. Then to quickly increase my protein intake, I bought a protein powder to try and use every day. Now to how I navigated getting around the house and doing my everyday activities. As I mentioned earlier, rolling office chairs are a really helpful thing that a lot of people already have at home. But because of the small wheels, it can be hard to get it to move when it's on carpet. Most of our downstairs is wood floors, but we do have a rug by the couch, so that transition of getting onto the rug is difficult, as well as trying to move the chair across the rug to get onto the couch. The wheels can pivot every which way, so that makes it hard to control the direction. If you've ever driven one of those carts at IKEA, you know what I'm talking about. The knee scooter, it's got much larger wheels, so that transition from floor to carpet and even rolling on carpet is much easier. Getting upstairs is tricky. I live in a 2-story house and all the bedrooms are upstairs, so I have to go down and up the stairs at least once a day. The first few days of using crutches, I was a sweaty mess by the time I got to the bottom of the stairs or I made my way back up. It's so much work balancing yourself and making sure you're not falling and hurting yourself even more. Our stairs have a landing and there's a U-turn, so I can take a break in the middle. But I choose to use the crutches rather than sit down on my butt and scoot up the stairs because it is so hard to get standing back up again using only 1 foot. I obviously can't drag my scooter up the stairs while I'm crutching my way up, so crutches are my only option for getting around once I get upstairs. The whole upstairs is carpeted except for the bathrooms. So in my bathroom, I have a wheelie office chair, and I rest my knee on that while I'm getting ready so I don't have to hold my foot up the entire time I'm like brushing my teeth, combing my hair, and all of that. And I can use my hands as well without having to like lean and balance on the crutches. In order to get dressed, I need to sit down at least for part of it in order to get the pant leg up my good leg since I can't put any weight on the bad leg. I sit down on a really short dresser that we have to get my pants on, which brings me to another issue, wearing pants and socks. The cast is so fat that pants with a cuff or that are tight at the ankle don't fit, and neither do regular socks. I have one set of some really stretchy slipper socks, so I put those at the end of my cast to cover up my toes to keep them warm because December in Colorado is cold. As far as pants, I live in yoga pants and wide leg pants. Once I was dressed and downstairs, getting around with the knee scooter was easy. Except I couldn't leave the house. To get into the garage, there's a couple stairs. To get out the front door, there's a couple stairs to get to the driveway. So I couldn't use my scooter to get out of the house. John quickly fixed this with some plywood he had found in a dumpster and some 2x4s. He built a ramp over the stairs, getting from the house into the garage, so I could use the scooter to leave the house. I quickly realized that in order to hop in and out of the car, either on my own, or if someone was with me and they were bringing the scooter around to the door where I was sitting, I needed space. And most parking lots, they cram the spaces in so tight, it's hard to get in and out even if you're uninjured. So I called the orthopedic doctor's office to see if I could get an accessible parking pass. They said to give them a few minutes for them to write up the paperwork that I would need to pick up, and then I would just have to take that to the DMV to get the accessible parking pass. So I went, picked up the paperwork, took that to the DMV, and within a half hour, I was in and out and had two accessible parking passes with me. I asked for two because we were going to be flying for Christmas, and I wanted to be able to use one in the car that we were parking at the airport parking lot, and then the other one for whatever car I was riding in when we were visiting my parents. One more thing in day-to-day life that immediately gets more difficult is showering. Since I wasn't allowed to put any weight on my foot, I wasn't going to be doing any sweaty activity frequently, other than going up and down the stairs with my crutches. So I wasn't going to be showering daily, but I wanted to shower at least once or twice a week. Since you aren't supposed to use crutches in the shower, which it sounds pretty dangerous anyway because it gets really slippery in there, so John brought up one of our patio chairs for me to sit in the shower. For my first shower, we just taped a garbage bag around my cast to keep it dry, and then John tried to aim the shower head the best he could at wherever he thought I would need it. There was no good spot for the shower head to be aimed because it is either aimed at you and drenching you the entire time that you're trying to wash your hair, wash your body, or it's at a funny angle and you've got to like lean around in weird spots to get yourself wet and rinse yourself off. It took a really long time and it was a lot of work. So after that first shower, I decided I needed a few upgrades. First, I got some real waterproof cast covers that I could use over and over, rather than having to tape a garbage bag to me and then ripping it off after every shower. Next, I got a handheld shower head so I could aim the water where I needed it or keep the spray away from, say, my hair while I was washing it. So those are the basics of getting around and trying to make things a little bit easier while you've got a cast on your leg. I knew it wasn't going to be easy, but it's been a real eye-opening experience realizing how many of your daily tasks are made so much more difficult when you can only use one leg. To learn more about how to make traveling, and more specifically flying, a little bit easier when you've got your leg in a cast, make sure that you're subscribed and you've clicked that bell to receive the notifications, because that's going to be the next video that I post here on my channel. I'll also be documenting how my recovery goes, so keep tuning in for updates. Thanks for watching!